Welcome back to Collecting Cars. Today we're at Classic Motor Cars to learn the top 10 things you should know before buying a Jaguar E-Type. Are you better suited to a 3.8 or a 4.2, a fixed head coupe or a roadster? Well, fortunately, we've got CMC's Tim Griffin here to help you decide. Hi, Tim.
Hi there.
Thank you very much for having us here at Classic Motor Cars.
Pleasure. Welcome.
Thank you. Well, straight off the bat, standing in front of this Series 1, it's wonderful to be here and be amongst all of these E-types. We wanted to come here today and talk to yourself. And the sort of premise of this, again, is one of our buyer's guides. And we're really sort of taking it as if I'm coming to you for your advice. And I've always wanted an E-Type.
Yeah, absolutely.
Where do we start?
Oh,
well, absolutely, that's it.
Why wouldn't you want an E-Type? And, I mean, look at them.
Yeah. They are absolutely stunning. Even Enzo Ferrari was sort of staggered with their beauty, wasn't it? And so I think for lots of us, when we sort of dream about having one of these cars, there's so much choice. Mm-hmm. And you can go online, you can see on Collecting Cars how many E-Types we've sold, and it can be quite overwhelming. So when someone comes to you and says, look, Tim, I'm really keen to get into one of these, where does the conversation go from there? Where do you start?
I suppose initially the conversation starts, and it can almost seem a little bit rude, is how tall are you?
Really?
You have to consider that the early E-types, especially the earlier 3.8s with the flat floors, there's limited room inside them. And, you know, somebody like you or I quite comfortably drive them. But if you've got somebody who's 6 foot plus or a bigger frame, it's probably a gorgeous looking car, but probably not the car for them.
Yeah.
As you go through the series, you get a little bit more space. So you have the 3.8, which has got the flat floor, very small bucket seats, limited on space. The later 3.8s had a recessed floor well, but you're still limited with the bucket space and seat. You got into the 4.2s, of which this one is an example.
Yep.
You have a seat that is semi-reclining. You get a bit more leg room, a bit more space to stretch out.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you get to the Series 3, which is the car behind, which is the ultimate grand tourer, I would say, of the E-Type model.
So we're standing by a Series 1 Roadster, and then what was after that, and what kind of iterations did they have within the Series 1?
So the very early Series 1 3.8, you've got the first 500 cars, which are known as the OBLs, which are the outside bonnet locks. They're the most valuable, they're the most collectible, and if you're looking at a car from a pure investment point of view, they're probably the ones that you would guide somebody down the route of buying.
Yeah.
But it's not necessarily the most practical or enjoyable car to own. Mm. And they were in both fixed head and drop head format, although there are very few of either, with only, from memory, 91 drop heads and 5 fixed heads in right-hand drive format.
Wow.
So they are, you know, they're very valuable cars by any stretch of the imagination, and quite difficult, you know, only come up on the market every so often and generally have a buyer. You then get into the 1961 onwards car, so the 62 to 64, late 63, 64, which is, you've got the 3.8s in fixed head and drop head form, and they all have recessed floor wells.
Nice.
But still have bucket seats. You then get onto in 64, you've got the 4.2. It went to the 4.2 engine, which is a longer stroke engine. More torque, a bit more people, a bit more lazy. Some people prefer the reviness of the 3.8. The 4.2 is still a very performance-orientated engine, but it's got a lot more torque, it's a lot lazier, it's a lot more comfortable to drive. You then get the seats that we've got in here that have a semi-reclining mechanism, more leg room, fully synchromesh gearbox, so you haven't got to come to a standstill to change into first.
Yeah.
They changed from using what was called the Moss box in the 3.8 to Jaguar's own all-synchro box, which is a very robust unit.
Yeah, and what was the difference between the Moss box?
So the Moss box, they call it the Moss box because that's the company that made it.
Right.
It derives from the standard gearbox, which was the name, again, standard, that was in the SS100s and the like, and cars are like. And it's a three-synchro gearbox, and the synchros are the synchros are built in to the gears, so it's a matched gear set, and you've got no synchro on first gear. So to change into, if you want to come to a standstill under first, you've got to come to a stop.
Yeah.
When they wear, there are a few specialists such as ourselves who can repair them and repair them properly when the synchros are worn, but not many. When they wear and you start to get wear on second to third, sometimes third to fourth, and especially coming down the box, a lot of people say there's not much to do with them. A lot of people will then put a all synchro gearbox in.
Yeah.
There's not any real problem with that. I think as long as you keep the Moss box and put it somewhere safe, particularly if it's a matching numbers car, because that's very important on early cars.
Absolutely.
The four synchro gearbox, which is the Jaguar's own box, which is the later one in all in the 4.2 range onwards, is an incredibly robust unit. As long as they're serviced oil, they don't tend to go wrong. It's in fairness, Jaguar's E-types full stop. They are generally robust cars. As long as they're looked after like any mechanical item, they tend to be long-lived and cause very few problems. We move on from the Series 1, the 4.2, which is in fixed head, and again in fixed head and drop head form. And you move to the Series 2 car, which is the car we can see, the red car we can see just over the back there.
And you can denote the differences straight off, really. The headlights and the front grilles are quite obvious.
Really quite obvious. There was an interim period, which people tend to refer to as the Series 1 and a quarter and the Series 1 and a half cars, which was the transformation. It didn't just stop at Series 1 and go to Series 2.
Yeah, it's sort of fettling all the time.
Fettling all the time. I mean, Jaguar and Lions in particular were very good at cost benefit, and they would make sure they used all the old parts before they got to the new parts. There's no saying that's the reason for it, but you know, there was definitely a changeover period. So you had some late Series 1 cars that would have open headlights like the Series 2, but would still keep the high indicator side lights and still keep toggle switches on the dash.
Yes.
And then you would find that they would go over to having the rocker switches on the dash of the Series 2, but still have the high side lights and the high back lights with open headlights. And then you've got the full reiteration of the Series 2 with the higher bumpers, the indicators and tail lights drop below the bumper, and the open headlights. A lot of it is about the American market. I think also you'll find, you know, unofficially, a lot of it is about changing the model.
Yeah.
So people will buy the new car.
So the American market, they had to meet certain sort of driving standards.
Had to meet certain driving standards, so pedestrian safety,
headlights. Had the very unsightly bumpers that they really ruined the front of it, didn't they?
When you got to the Series 3, you found they had what we call the Americanized bumpers. They had to be able to survive, do a 5 mph impact. So you see the Series 3s, Americanized Series 3s, with the big rubber bumpers on the front.
That's right,
like that.
Yeah. They're almost little fins on the front.
They are, absolutely. What you can't see behind that is on an Americanized car, the bonnet and the rear end is actually all reinforced to cope with that, to meet that impact testing.
Right.
I mean, as it happens, E-types are actually, for a classic car, actually generally a very safe car. They are very strong, and with this long bonnet and the Reynolds framework, it has a natural crumple zone.
Yes, there's a long way from the front.
It's a long way from the front to the driver to absorb impact should the worst happen.
Yes,
which actually makes it a very, very safe classic to drive.
Yeah,
and with a very, very strong tub, not unlike a modern car.
So we know there's those choices then, so between 1, 2 and 3 and fixed head versus Roadster. We're stood in front of this beautiful Series 1 Roadster. Talk me around the car a little bit, and some of the things that, if I've decided that this is the one that I want a Series 1 Roadster, what sort of things would I be looking at that are specific to this car? And then we can look at the 2 and 3 and look at the things that are specific to those as we go through. But if we sort of take this as an example and kind of work around, what would you say if I came to you with this car and said, look, what should we be looking out for?
Well, I think with any classic, and in particular, and I would also say with E-types, that any classic of value is its identity. Make sure what you're buying is what it proclaims to be. There's a lot of talk about matching numbers, and I think it's particularly applies to E-types. There were a lot of E-types made. There's some 72, 78,000 E-types produced.
Wow. That's a big number when you consider how many Aston made.
That's a big number when you consider
the,
you into 5,000 to 6,000 Astons.
Yeah.
So make sure the car you're buying is what you're getting. You know, it's not an American car that's been bought over and given a British British ID. History, you know, a lot of these cars do tend to come with good history. They've been through a restoration, so there should be a restoration history for the car, or it's a very original car, which again would you would expect to see history from. You get a heritage certificate from Jaguar Daimler Heritage Trust, who will confirm the numbers you have given them are correct to the records they hold. That isn't always the case on particularly early cars, because there was it's not unusual to have a body number that's slightly out of sequence, and that was to do with the build. So all E-types went through the track on a body number, not a chassis number.
Right.
So it would start as a body number, that would be allocated an engine and a gearbox number, which would be stamped up accordingly to the body, and then the very last thing it received was the chassis number stamped into the frame.
Right.
So
sort of first sort of top tip then is check the
numbers,
body and chassis numbers.
Check the body and chassis numbers. There's, as with any car, there's not a problem buying a car that isn't matching numbers, as long as you're aware of it and you pay and you buy accordingly.
So that just comes down to a value thing, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So it's a case of, fine, if it's not matching numbers, depends again how you want to use
how
the
you
car.
Want to use the car. What you're going to use the car for.
If it's really important to you that it's all original, or that you're buying for an investment, then of course matching numbers, super
history, heritage certificate, all that side of it is important. If you're buying a car because you love it and you want to drive it, and it's not matching numbers, that's great. That's not a problem, as long as if you go into it with your eyes wide open
and the price is reflected. Yeah.
Which, in some cases, where it comes to, you know, as with buying any car, in an average 4.2 drop head such as this, around £100,000, would be around £100,000. Why wouldn't you get somebody who knows what they're looking at to go and check it for you?
Yes.
You know, a few hundred pounds for somebody to make sure, you know, an expert to make sure that it's correct is negligible in the grand scale of things. The other thing to look about when you're buying an E-type is, I think we've probably touched on it briefly, is how you're going to use it. What do you want to use the car for? We've talked about size. How tall are you? You know, I think there's probably a limit to how comfortable you would be in an early flat floor car with bucket seats. Mm. You know, a Series 3 drop head or fixed head, you know, you could be 6'5" and 15 stone and fit really comfortably. Mm. It's also what you're going to use the car for. Are you going to go for a drive down to the pub on a Sunday, 20, 30 miles, park it outside on a sunny afternoon, have a pint and drive back, if that's the case, or go to a show? That's the case, an early 3.8 is probably what you'd want, because it's arguably the prettiest car.
Yeah.
If you're wanting to go and use the car for touring, then for touring, depending on how you're going to drive, and you may want to go for a Series 1 4.2 fixed head. Incredibly practical car, lovely to drive, comfortable over distance. With the ultimate E-type for touring, personally, I would say is something like the V12. They're looked at, I think, as a bit of an underdog within the E-type community, but actually, they are the most practical car.
Yeah, longer legs, probably.
Longer legs. They are no slouch by anybody's imagination.
Yeah.
However, this is where I think they wrongly get put aside. It was never meant to be the sports car that the 3.8 was.
Yeah.
If you need to think of the V12 as a gentleman's express. If you look at it from that point of view, as its successor, the XJS, as a gentleman's express and not a sports car, they make perfect sense.
Yeah. Makes sense.
And they're great cars.
You said to me earlier, one of the things that's so important is bodywork. So let's look around the car. And what do you mean by that specifically? What should I be looking at when I'm kind of walking around the car?
So you can actually see a lot of the hidden areas where the corrosion starts on E-types. You don't necessarily need to be on a ramp if you know where you're looking for. I would always say with an E-type, buy a body. Everything else is nuts and bolts.
Yeah.
The most expensive part to get to put right by a long shot is the bodywork. For argument's sake, a new bonnet is just shy of £10,000 plus the VAT. A set of engine frames, bear in mind they're chrome moly frames and can't be repaired, you have to replace if they're damaged or corroded. A set of engine frames is around £4,000.
Yeah.
And to fit a bonnet, to fit and paint a bonnet, you're looking at 80 to 100 hours labour. To fit a set of frames, you're looking at 40 to 60 hours labour.
So is that just a case of looking at the paintwork, opening up the yeah. bonnet, looking for rust
yes,
or
so
any corrosion?
There are key areas we can, if we open the doors and we can point in areas of this car, yeah. the key areas you can look at that I think from the outside without going on a ramp are quite good giveaways as to the quality of any work that's been okay. done before you get too deep into it.
Yeah, let's
so
go through those.
If we open the bonnet on this car.
Wow, look at that. Just fabulous.
Yeah.
And the thing with the E-Type as well is when you go, other than revealing that beautiful 4.2 litre engine, when you go around the front of the car, just the way that sort of pivots open, it looks
yeah,
fantastic, doesn't it?
They're
sort of the nose of the car almost touches the ground there.
Yeah, it's there's adjustable clearance on them, so it is an art to setting it up.
Right. So where are these
so,
points that you need
so,
to look
so,
at?
So the key points you need to look at engine frames. So if we look at the engine frames, when they get damaged. Damage is quite easily visible on them.
Yeah.
Part of that we do need to look at on the ramp. There are key points where you can point out where if the suspension's taken or not, it will put a kink in the frame that's quite easily visible.
Yeah.
They can crack where the engine mounting is. Again, we can point that out underneath to the outside. And the bonnet hanging frame, again, look at the bonnet, and you need to look at areas around here. And here for any signs of damage or repair, as if it's taken a knock on the bonnet and it's had a bonnet put on but not a frame, that is again another very typical area. The frames do corrode from the inside out.
Right.
They're chrome moly frames, and whereas you can change an entire tube and braze it in, it's an expert thing, and it's usually only done on historic cars for display. You know, you wouldn't want to do it on a car that you're going to drive every day. You would have to replace a whole frame set. A good indication as to whether the frames have corroded or not is, one, is to tap them and see what they sound like. You see that's got quite a high ring. It doesn't yeah. sound dull. If there was corrosion on the inside, you would get that sound would be muffled a little bit from the corrosion.
Yeah. Okay.
And in extreme cases, where you can see this nice cold forming of the frame, they can look a bit oval. Bit blown,
okay.
And if you've got one like that, you have a serious problem with corrosion.
So nice smooth surfaces.
Yeah,
a very squared off.
Yeah. Ideally, you know, they shouldn't have a lot of paint on. You can actually see the cold form. You can actually see the cold drawing on that tube if you look.
Yeah.
Yes, you can. These frames have been replaced recently, I would say, with a good quality set. And check that side of it. So. It doesn't look blown, doesn't sound dull when you tap it. You've got a nice ring to it because they're quite a taut. When they're brazed up, they're quite taut settings.
Yeah.
They're quite taut. And just check them round for cracks. Another one under the bonnet is checking this area. So it's not uncommon if it hasn't had the right hosing on to leak here, and you can get bubbling around this area
yeah.
where the brake fluid leaks. We tend to recommend people use a silicone brake fluid.
Okay.
You don't get quite such a hard bite on the pedal, but it's, you know, you still, your brakes are still very good. And if you do get a leak, you're not going to corrode the car.
Yeah. So it just sort of collects in this.
It collects. They're collected here. It's a natural collection point.
Yeah.
Another good one is where the sills have been put on. So, you know, looking for a nice sharp lines and. This car has very obviously had sills, but they've been well done.
Yeah.
You know, if you suddenly start seeing big steps here, or you know, a big taper in this line,
yeah.
you know, it's just showing like lines of filler, or you know, poor fitting. Again, we've got nice sharp line all the way down the A-post here where the panel's fitted.
Yeah.
It's not been built out with filler or there's anything, doesn't look anything untoward there.
Yeah.
One, it's a quite tricky to set up. I think they, you know, they definitely require a degree of skill and knowledge.
Yeah, I bet.
So you know, it's you're looking for nice bonnet gaps, fairly even gaps all the way around.
Yeah, I mean, these lines on the doors, for example, are just are so tight, aren't they?
Yeah, they are, and you have to have a reasonable gap. When you open and shut a door on E-Type, it naturally runs very close, so you have very little space. So it's important that the gaps are there. The gaps shouldn't be huge. The gaps should be fairly tight. If you think up to sort of 3/16 of an inch.
And all of these things that we're talking about now are relevant to series two and three as well,
yeah,
aren't
to,
they?
To all the mark, yes. To all the mark. The gaps out of Jaguar, contrary to what you may hear, were actually generally pretty good. They were fairly consistent, and they were pretty decent.
Yeah.
They weren't as horrendous as what's made out. So there's no reason it shouldn't still be a fairly nicely gapped car.
Good. Okay. Let's come backwards from the engine and the bonnet to where are we going next?
So if we go immediately, we open the door to get in the car. So with any E-Type, is see how it sits on the latch. So this one actually sits quite nice. It's not riding the latch. It doesn't feel like it's clunking when you open and shut the door.
Yeah.
And it's very easy to open the door and have it in this position where the most weight is on it, because it's a quite a small hinge pin.
Yeah.
And you've got the weight of the entire door and all the fittings on it. And just lift it a little bit. It's not unusual to have a little bit of play.
Yeah.
A little bit, just purely in the weight of the door. But if you're lifting it and you're getting half inch worth of play at this end, you've got a problem that you need to either repin the hinge or put a new hinge on it.
Okay.
Even on a ramp, on a two-post ramp, the door should open and close. Unlike an XK with a separate chassis and you get that flex, you shouldn't have that issue on an E-Type. If you're having problems, if you can't open and shut the door on an E-Type, a drop head, let alone a fixed head on the ramp, walk away from it.
Yeah, because there's a chassis.
Because there's a problem.
Yeah, okay.
Other areas they can corrode is important, is to look in this area here. So you can sometimes see blowing here, they can collect water in the bottom while we're on the outside of the car, on the A-post here. You have a bit of a water trap here where the drain is, and then make sure that these feel the bottom of the doors. The doors, you know, that you should be able, it's a normal door skin on a frame. It should feel like three layers of metal thick. If you're feeling the bottom of the door and it feels like a quarter of an inch thick, there's a lot of filler in there. And generally, if there's filler, there's something unwanted behind it.
Is it, people talk about going around with magnets to spot filler. Is that a useful technique,
I think it can be. I think it's a little bit hit and miss and a bit old school. What you have to remember is there's a lot of lead on E-types.
Yes.
And a magnet won't stick to lead.
Yeah.
What is by far better to do, to buy a proper paint film thickness tester, and not the magnetic type, the electronic type. Yeah. You can pick a Chinese one up from eBay for £10-15, and it's not as good as what I would use if I was going to look at one, but it will do the job, and it will read, as long as it's reading to a ferrous or non-ferrous substrate, metal substrate, it will give you a reading.
Yeah.
It won't read fiberglass, it won't read through to plastic, but you will read to the lead.
And what would you be looking for then? What kind of readings?
I would say it depends on the quality of the car, but I think realistically, if you've got less than 1,000 microns, less than 1 millimetre on a restored car, that's quite acceptable. Some people might argue. But the way that a lot of these cars are prepared now with modern primers and top coats, and block through, it's not unusual to see that. In areas that have been repaired, you might expect to see, it could have a very structurally safe repair behind it, but if somebody's MIG welded it and then knock the repair low and put filler in, you could see a bit more filler. Again, as long as you're buying a wear and you're paying the right price, it's not a problem. If somebody's TIG'd it and it's been planished up properly and you've got 700 microns there where the repair is, that's a quality repair, and you know you would expect to pay a bit more.
Yeah.
One of the things is to remember with E-types, they've, unlike sort of Ferraris and even Astons to a point, because there were so many built, they've gone through that phase where they haven't been worth a lot of money, and there's been a lot of home restorations been done with love, but not necessarily skill.
Yes.
And there are a lot of skilled home restorations out there, but there's also a lot that aren't that sharp. And they, you know, they're perfectly safe, but you might find it's got, yeah, there is a bigger paint build, particularly on a fixed head along maybe a line here, which is where the repair panels come to.
Mm-hmm.
Or if somebody's put, you know, rather than put a complete A-post in, somebody's welded, you have to take the bottom off the wing and the bottom off the A-post to change the seal properly.
Right, okay.
So you have to cut it off and then weld a new section in.
Wow, yeah.
So if you're not changing, the rest of the panel's good. If we were doing this, we would probably cut a join about here, but we would TIG weld that join and we would planish it and it would be a metal finish.
Yeah.
And you wouldn't have it, but if it's been MIG welded and it's been beaten in a little bit and then filled to shape, you can expect to see a bigger thickness of paint build there. Doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad car.
No.
Just means there's been a repair there, which you have to do to change the seal.
Yeah.
This area, on any E-type, this area, when measuring, and this area, usually along here as well, and this area, are leaded.
Right.
So it's the sill to the bottom of the quarter and the sill to the bottom of the A-post is a join like that. And from the factory, they are literally, arc, MIG, tacked, and then leaded over. And the lead goes into the seam. So again, that's another water trap.
Yeah.
So you can see bubbling along here. Although we're on a Series 1, when you come to a Series 3, it's not unusual to see a crack here.
Okay. Why is that?
It's body flex. Doesn't necessarily mean there's a problem with the car.
Yeah.
But with the extra wheelbase,
Just has a little bit.
Has a little bit more flex, and it's not uncommon to see a crack. There's a point between when it's a problem and when it isn't, but a hairline crack there isn't unusual. Doesn't necessarily mean you should go, oh, I'm going to walk away from this one.
No. Okay.
It just needs somebody who knows what they're looking at to say, that's not unusual, or that could be a problem.
Not necessarily a scary bill. Round to the sort of the back haunches then of the car.
Yeah, so we go round to the back.
Now, interesting thing I was told about the E-types was that when you open the boot compartment, all the originals were all done in this same colour.
Yeah, they were all the originals. All E-types were done in biscuit in the boot.
Yeah,
and it's an illusion. It makes it appear as though there's more space.
Is that right? That's the reason for it. Yeah. I wondered why it was. I thought
if that was black, it would look quite impressive in there. It'd look small. With it being biscuit, it looks like you've got more room.
And presumably over the course of time, that's not someone's particular flavour. So some people have
retrim them in carpet. We'll trim the carpet to match the car.
But it's a nice thing to know, because then you can tell that's then original.
Yeah. The back arches, which we can see in a minute, and look coming around the back, is there is another join here that can corrode on E-types, and round the bottom. Generally, corroding around the bottom of the arches and along here, which it can be seen by uneven in the shape, is where is where the panels are welded.
Yeah, so that's just the seam underneath the bumper, is it?
Yeah, and what's very easy with these is, I would say, it's very easy to take the boot board out, the spare wheel, and anything the owner may have in the boot, to look inside the boot. And I think it's very important to do that, and it's probably worth us doing now, actually.
Yes, let's lift that up. There we are.
getting all those smells from the 60s just
as you
pull the liner out there.
Yeah.
Does that just lift out?
Yeah, I think this is probably, this shouldn't be loose, but I think it probably is in this car. It's like, there you go. So what is worth looking at is just getting the things out. So the wheel tucks under and comes out quite easy. So have a look in the boot. Again, from looking at this car, we can see it's actually in very good order.
It is, isn't it?
There's nothing nasty. The giveaways you're looking at is like any heavy corrosion or repairs around. In fact, you can just see where it's had the bottom of the arch repaired there.
It's redone, yeah.
Redone.
It's nice that this is something that you can do yourself, isn't it? You don't need a specialist to do that.
Absolutely. You can do all of this yourself. It's very easy to look at. It's knowing what you're looking for. Mm. So we're looking at areas round here for any repairs. This should all look like a nice, tight, spot-welded joint, which is exactly what it is. You know, with a torch, you can look in here.
Yeah.
With an up inside the wheel arch.
I just so happen to have
you
a torch.
You happen to have a torch.
On me there.
Absolutely.
You can get right in there.
So we can look right in here to see what's going on in here, and then we can get right up inside the arch to see what's going up inside the arch. So it's not unusual for water to collect in here. So it's important to make sure all these drain holes, people, again, do seem to see a habit of people bunging these up.
Right.
Leave them open. It lets it vent and it lets the water out.
Good circulation, particularly if the car's going to be stored.
Absolutely. The other nice thing about with the E-types doing this is you've got full access to the petrol tank. Yeah. So you can see if there are any leaks on the top plate, on the pickup plate or on the sender unit. Because when the petrol tank is full, both of these are immersed.
Yeah. Do you get quite a lot of any moisture here sort of collecting? Or?
Only, it's generally...
It's checking.
You don't tend to get it collecting here, but it can collect under the tank.
Yeah.
And it can collect under the back in the spare wheel well here. And that's when you start having problems. So if you keep those free, if anything does get in there, it gets out.
Yeah, great.
So these pipes are the drain pipes for the boot.
Right, okay.
For the boot aperture.
Yeah.
And also the pipe that runs off here actually runs to a Y piece that's soldered into the boot floor.
Okay.
So that runs inside the boot as well. So just make sure there's no moisture, there's no water getting into the boot.
Is that case? Just stick
something down.
Stick something down.
I'm not doing a...
Going to do an inspection.
No. A little half-litre bottle of, the half-litre bottle of water you buy from the supermarket.
Yes.
Fill one of those with tap water and just fill it up and see where it goes.
Top tip there. Fantastic.
Yeah, and you can do the same in the gutter.
Yeah.
Just half-litre, just fill it up and see where the water goes.
So bring your torch with you and a little water bottle.
A little water bottle.
You'll be pouring it down there.
And just make sure that the water goes, one, it's just not blocked up, and two, it actually doesn't go and sit in the boot.
Yeah. Great. So that's the majority of the exterior of the car. What about when we sort of move to look at the interior of the car? What are the things that we should be looking out for?
Okay. So on the interior, most Jaguars, they're fairly robust. What Jaguar are very good at doing is what you touched and what you looked at was leather. What you didn't was vinyl, but looked like leather.
Yeah.
This car's had a retrim at some stage in its life,
yeah.
And it's been done in leather.
Holding the door cards there, so, leather.
Yeah, leather, leather. Leather on the seat, on the. So normally the rolls on the seat, these would be leather. The backs on an earlier car are in maquette. The later ones are in vinyl.
Yeah. So imagine a lot of them have been retrimmed. Yeah. If I'm looking at a car which has been retrimmed and it's. Mm-hmm. Particularly nice as this one is. How does that affect values, if at all, between something that's original?
I think there's always a value attached to originality.
Mm.
But to do that, I think the whole car needs to be original.
Yeah. Otherwise, it's kind of.
Otherwise, you might as well. Yeah, it's as we talked about here. We're talking about fools and horses and the triggers broom syndrome.
Yeah.
Now, If most cars have had a restoration, will have had a retrim.
Yeah.
The quality of retrims varies. and it's down to what you're looking for, and the value of the car, you know, will reflect some of the value of the car. It's not the end of the world if you go and if you're looking for an E-Type. If you were looking for an E-Type and you loved this car, but you said, "Oh, Tim, I can't stand Biscuit as an interior," I said, "Well, that's not the end of the world."
Yeah,
you know, it without taking the car apart and putting it back together, it would cost you 60,000 to 70,000 to do the bodywork.
Yeah.
And so paint it.
That's the important. Yeah. That's the important bit.
A retrim. Bear in mind, you don't need to do the dash because they're always black.
Yes. Yeah.
A retrim would probably cost you, depending how far you went, 8 to 8.5
Yeah. Yeah. So get the right car. Worry about the.
Get the right car.
The trim later.
Worry about the trim later. The series that through are pretty similar. The basic layout is the same. The early cars had that nice aluminium polka dot dash, which later went to the cross hat dash that followed through the centre console. You didn't get the armrest and cubby box.
Right.
The Series 1, 4.2s and Series 2 cars are pretty much all the same as this, with the exception of, on the Series 2s, the toggle switches were replaced with rocker switches, a bit more robust.
Yeah.
The radio tower differed slightly to accommodate, and you had proper reclining seats.
Yeah.
So the seats, as I probably heard me mention, of a semi-reclining on the 4.2s. They're semi-reclining because it's a little flap here that you pop back, and it allows the back of the seat to drop by about 3 or 4 mil, which gives you, you know, 3/8 of an inch, 1/2 inch, 1/2 inch at the top.
Yeah. So there's not actually sort of too many sort of areas of concern. It's really kind of comes down to condition, personal preference.
Condition, like personal preference. It's all, like, as with any car, it's definitely worth checking the release mechanisms, both inside and out. They can wear, wind the windows up and down. The mechanisms can wear, and if they tend to wind down okay, but on the wind up, if you start skipping or missing a notch, which is very obvious, you're into a new winder mechanism, which, although not the end of the world, you need to budget for and make sure that the car's bought accordingly. It's about 4 hours labour and £250 for the parts. So, you know, you have to do two of those. All of a sudden, you're spending another £1,000 on the car.
Yeah. So well worth checking.
Little bits and pieces.
These are easy things to sort of, you know, they seem obvious, but they're easy things to forget when you're sort of getting caught up in the moment of, you know, going out for a drive in a car.
Oh.
You've got the windows down because it's a nice day, and then you forget to do it.
Buy
the car, and then later you find out that you've got, you know, £1,000 bill.
Yeah. Check the handbrake. It's an assist rather than a handbrake like a modern car. We can look at those in depth underneath.
Are they all fly-off handbrakes?
They're not fly-off handbrakes. It's only the XKs that had fly-off handbrakes. Yeah. All E-types are normal push. But what is worth mentioning is when the ignition's on, the light there is the brake warning light mechanism for the reservoirs and the handbrake. Hmm. Is make sure the handbrake, that light goes out when you push the handbrake down.
Yeah.
If that stays on, even with the handbrake pushed right down, the switch to replace it is right in the transmission tunnel down here behind all the trim. So it's both seats out, radio tower out,
center
console out.
Oh my god.
To change the switch.
Yeah, just one switch.
Yeah, to change the switch. Yeah. So it's worth checking that. The other thing I always do with
that's a very easy check then. Just turn that ignition on and you'll see that red
very,
light.
Very, very easy check. I mean, one of the jobs we've got to do on this car, which I will demonstrate in a moment, check the heaters, check the flaps are moving. You can hear them, you can feel them move. These levers operate the flaps. You can operate the flaps in the airbox.
Yeah.
So you can actually physically see and hear the flaps moving.
Yeah.
So you can actually see the valve here.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
And then you operate the other one and you can see moving the flap, make sure those move.
Yeah.
And they're not seized. So the other thing to do, and we do need to look at it on this car, is another thing I will always say, and I think is quite important. I know this is a job to do on this car, so it's actually quite a good demonstration. Is to open this, the center drop panel. There are two milled nuts that hold it in place.
Yeah.
Very simple to do. I would say, do we look at it in this car? Because I know it's a job to do. This should open. You can see here it fells the radio tower slightly.
Yeah.
It's a simplish adjustment to get this right.
Hmm.
But behind there is the entire fuse board for the car. You really, you know, want to make sure that you've got access to that, because should you need to change a fuse or something happens, you need to be able to get in there.
Yeah, yeah. Let's close this one up. We'll put all the things back into the boot, close down on it, and then we'll get it up on the ramp here. Just have a quick look underneath before we go and look at two and three.
Absolutely.
Right, so underneath this example.
Underneath the E-Type, yes. So if we start with the body side of it where we were and move back, as we were talking with corrosion, the area to look for is here. Again, a bit of a natural water trap. You do have these big drains, but you can see, if you see bubbling along here, then you know it's a sign that you've got some corrosion in place.
Yeah.
We can also start looking for accident damage to the engine, to the frames, as we talked about being chrome moly.
Yes.
If they're damaged, they're not repairable, you have to change the whole unit.
Okay.
That can be just a side frame or just a bonnet frame, but you do have to change a unit.
Yeah.
Again, we look for any, there's very telltale signs where they give, and it's usually where you've got a braised joint, where you get a stress raise at the joint, where to go. Another one to look for is excessive damage on the picture frame. So you can see here where this picture frame has been, it's been jacked up on here. It's quite a safe and strong structure to jack the car up on, and not generally a problem. But what we always advise people is to put a block of wood in here.
Yeah, in between.
And it just stops you crushing these.
This isn't too bad, but you can clearly see where someone's had a go.
See where somebody's had a go at jacking it up, and it's caused some damage in the past. In extreme circumstances, these can bend, and of course that will bring the front geometry in and throw the suspension out.
Yeah.
Okay. Very rare.
So if you
rare.
Can't get up on a ramp, if you're going for a drive, if you're pulling, that could be one.
If it pull it,
possible.
Yeah. One possible why. Reason. Yeah. E-types actually drive very well. They're arguably one of the best driving classic cars. It's almost driving a modern car. It shouldn't feel heavy. Certainly shouldn't feel heavy. It shouldn't feel sluggish. It shouldn't feel like it's you watch the old films where you're doing this to go in a straight line. It's they're very taut, very responsive, quick cars. And it should feel like that.
Yeah.
We talked earlier about the frame. So typical areas where you can get stress fractures in the engine frames is here where the engine mounts is, and here where they're brazed.
Okay.
So that's a good area to check. You can check all these areas without it being on a ramp with a torch and a bit of pretty prepared to lie on your back.
Here we are. Get up in
so
there.
we're looking here.
One of the great things about these cars is that when you do get underneath them, it's very easy with a torch just to see all of the sort of tubular framing and the chassis there, and just kind of check it. It's quite easy even with this torch just to sort of see what's going on up there.
Yeah, there's a lot of space around them. There's nothing that's hidden away or pocketed that you can't get to.
Yeah.
Again, with talks about the suspension, we check the bushes for perishing.
Yeah.
So you can see the bushes where they're fitted. You can see quite easily if the bushes are perished on the suspension or the dampers. And the anti-roll bar. Again, that's nuts and bolts. It's not the end of the world, but it's something that needs to be budgeted for if it needs working. It tends to be very obvious if you've got problems like with the bushes when you drive an E-Type. You'll notice it as you would with a modern car. If you go over a bump and you get a knock, then you can a safe assumption that either the top or bottom wishbone washers have got some wear in them. The brakes, this has actually got slightly later Series 2 brakes on it.
Yeah. What's the difference between the two? Because they were discs all round.
They were always discs all round. The very early cars, the 3.8s, the very early 3.8s, had what they call either Dunlop or Kelsey Haynes bellows, which used to create, as you pushed the brake pedal, the bellows created a vacuum which drew off for the from the engine, and then drew the vacuum to the power assistance to the brakes.
Yeah.
Again, there's a bit of a fallacy around those that they're not particularly good. Most of the problems we see with the cars with Kelsey Hayes Dunlop bellows brakes on, where people are complaining, is because the system hasn't been set up properly. There is a specific way to set the system up, and if they're set up properly, they're generally pretty good. But later cars, the 4.2s, all had what we know, you know, assume as modern braking with servo assistant brake, proper right. servo assist, modern type servo assistant braking.
So a lot of series ones then get the later brakes.
So all cars from 1964 onwards, 4.2s, series twos, series threes, all had servo assist, what we now know as servo assisted brakes.
Yeah.
The earlier cars, 4.2, still used a very similar system to the 3.8, which had separate pistons, caliper pistons that bolted onto a housing. The brakes on an E-Type should never feel feeble. It's arguably the best classic cars to drive. The brakes should feel powerful and pull up straight. You shouldn't have that. I feel like I need to leave an extra 60 yards as you do in some classic cars.
Yes.
If it's not, you have to start thinking what's wrong with the braking system. They shouldn't feel wooden and they shouldn't feel feeble.
Yeah.
The suspension is all done through torsion bar.
Yeah.
To the reaction plate here. So as we were talking about the body tub being a very strong unit, this is why it's paramount to the integrity of the unit, because all the stress from the front suspension is put through this reaction plate, through the reaction plate, down the torsion bar here, through the reaction plate, and then through the chassis. Like all XK engine Jaguars, very robust unit. It's a very simple twin overhead cam Hemi system. They are quite lazy engines, believe it or not, despite the briskness of the drive, and they're not particularly stressed. Particularly 4.2 with the longer stroke.
Yeah.
If there is a weakness on the engine, it's oil leaks. People often, you know, you often hear it said, if you've got a Jaguar and it's not leaking oil, it's run out. there are ways and means around it, but I wouldn't let small oil leaks put you off buying an E-Type. This is actually fairly typical. I would suspect, looking at it, maybe the front and rear crank oil seal, or maybe even just the seal from the sump to the rear main and to the front pulley might be the case. So if it's the main crank oil seal, it is quite an involved job. It's an engine out job. You have to take the crank out to do it properly. I mean, there are people who say you can do it in situ. Not really. Not to do it properly, because you have to gap the oil seal to the crank. Even with the standard graphogen impregnated rope seal, if it's gapped properly to the crank, they tend to be pretty good. It will leak again at some stage. Another trick is with them is keep the oil halfway between full and max on the dipstick.
Yeah.
If you put it to the max, particularly if you park on a slope, you've got all the oil sits against the rear crank oil seal. So you've got you're asking it to leak.
Yeah.
You shouldn't have any low down rumbles. You get a little bit of valve train noise, but it shouldn't be excessive. Any ticking that sounds out of sync could indicate either a worn bucket, a stuck bucket, or simply just needing the valve clearances doing.
Yeah.
That side of it isn't a huge job. It's about a day's work to do the valve clearances, assuming it's just the clearances. But again, it's fairly simple stuff. You can just by listening, you can tell if something's not in sync.
And what about we've gone through so many things now where I'm getting to the point where I'm feeling right. I know which version I want. Mm-hmm. I know the things to look out for. But when I've actually made the purchase, what about sort of service and maintenance? What are they like to live with? Is it costly to run on an annual basis?
Service and maintenance. No, they're not costly cars to run. They're actually, you know, they're actually quite cost-efficient cars to run. If you buy the right car, the point is it's worth spending that little bit more money and getting the right car that doesn't need work doing, unless you budget for that and do it rightly.
Yeah.
What we always do with a service, there are interim and major services. Mm. So an interim service would be, say, an oil and filter change, grease the point and check over, and it's, you know, with a proper road testing going through it, it's probably around £350, £400, something like that.
Yeah.
A full service is probably double that.
Yeah.
But a full service, we would change all the oils, engine, gearbox, differential, all the fluids, grease all the points, and go through the whole, grease all the points of the car and go through the whole car.
Yeah.
One thing I tend to say to people is oils in your car, particularly if it doesn't do a lot of miles, it's not like a fine wine. They don't get better with age.
No. Need to keep changing.
You do need to keep. They absorb moisture, they absorb hydrocarbons.
Yeah.
And it's actually more important to do regular oil changes on a lower mileage car than what it is on a car that's used.
Yeah. It's just not getting up to temperature.
It's just not getting up to temperature. It's not getting the fluids around. And likewise in storage is quite, it's always recommend to people that if the weather's decent, just go and drive the car.
Yeah.
You know, get the oil splashed around the gear, get the oil pump working in the gearbox, get it splashed around, get all the oil around the car. So otherwise, you're sitting in a pool of oil and half of it's sitting to atmosphere and half of it's sitting in oil. Yeah.
The low mileage cars aren't always the best.
Absolutely.
That's the thing, isn't it?
Some of the best driving cars we get are people who get out and do tours and rallies and drive the cars and enjoy them.
All the niggles have been sorted out then, haven't they?
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
And when you're in this sort of age of car, you know, again, like, miles doesn't matter if it's been well looked after and serviced. It's not a problem.
Absolutely not. Don't worry too much about oil leaks as long as they're not horrendous. Check the oil condition level of a car. Again, as you would with any car, you take the filler cap off, check for breathing issues. Gearboxes again. This is the four synchro Jaguar box as opposed to the earlier Moss box. Again, very robust unit.
Yeah.
Listen for any whining. So if you're sitting in the car and it's idling, you can hear whine. Put your foot on the clutch. If it goes away, the chances are the bearings are worn on them, starting to wear on the lay shaft or there's some wear in the lay shaft itself. That is generally the only thing that really tends to see any problems on the gearbox, and that's more age related.
Right.
If you have a problem with crunching the gears, it could be due to the car being driven a bit spiritedly, but it's all doable. Everything's doable in them, and so they're quite a robust unit. I think you
clutches need on these clutches, relatively easy to
clutches
easy to swap
the
out.
Yep, the clutches and the actual unit itself isn't particularly expensive. Worth mentioning with most Jaguars, especially post 1950s, pretty much everything is available off the shelf. There is nothing you can't buy for them.
Yeah.
And E-types, it's not like you're buying an Aston or a Ferrari where you can't get a part, and the parts aren't expensive either.
It's a real thing, because you know you get into something like we were looking at 355s, we did a buyer's guide on Ferrari 355s and 360s. Go and check that out. But what was interesting was that Ferrari didn't actually have a load of parts sitting on the shops. So they were harder to come by.
Yeah.
Whereas if you go to Porsche Heritage will have a load.
Absolutely.
Same with Jaguar, by the sounds of things. They've got plenty of parts.
It's more with Jaguar is the independent specialists who've taken up the role. Although Jaguar Heritage are now producing a lot more things. But there's so many producers. It's like a clutch, a complete new clutch assembly for an E-Type is around £250.
Yeah.
It's not expensive.
By the sounds of it, the sort of service and maintenance and swapping out parts seems to be what I'd expect if I was taking my daily sort of beta down to a local garage. Doesn't seem like these are any different to a modern car. Yeah, really.
Nothing on them is scary. You know, the certain things you want, you know, gearbox or racks or to a specialist, but say they're fairly robust, very rare they go wrong. Oil leaks is the main thing. Valve clearances, once they're set, depending on the mileage you're doing, Jaguars, I can't remember what it is in the Jaguar manual, it's about 6,000 miles or something like that, but I think they're much longer intervals than that with modern oils and with the way the cars are used now. They're just a very, very, they're simple but work.
Yeah.
Coming through the car, the whole rear suspension assembly is independent. So it's called the IRS, independent rear suspension. And everything is mounted on this subframe. Interestingly, went from the very first E-Type right through to the last of the XJs, used a very similar system.
Similar on the Triumphs as well, didn't they? The TR4s had...
Yeah, very similar system. Arguably the most difficult thing to do on any service and maintenance on an E-Type, basic service and maintenance, is the rear brakes. and it is generally easier to drop the IRS to do the work and put it back in than try and do it in situ. Differentials, again, it's a Salisbury diff. Very rare you have problems with them. If they're noisy, it's generally worn bearing or crown wheel and pinion not set correctly from a restoration or previous rebuild. They tend to have very little go wrong with them. Brakes can get hot from the diff, so it's worth just checking that out, making sure that you can, you know, you can spin the wheel. Yep. There's no dragging on the brakes. Check the discs for being blue, so they can get quite warm at the back end.
Yeah.
Handbrakes can stick and seize. Again, it's IRS has got to come out to do the job.
Yeah.
Most, but not all E-types have limited slip differentials. So again, if you're off the jacks, worth just spinning the wheels.
Just see.
See if they both go the same way or not.
Yes.
Find out whether it's got a limited slip in or not. Other than that, there's actually very little to go wrong with them. Definitely worth checking the mountings on the IRS. There's V mountings on, metallastic mountings.
Yeah.
They can crack and perish, and that's all that holds the back end in.
Yeah. You want to check that one?
I mean, it's wonderful to be able to see everything, but I was just admiring the beauty actually from underneath this, because the lines are as smooth underneath the back end here as they are from when the car's sat on the ground.
Absolutely.
Especially the exhaust.
Yeah, the exhaust. And on a flat floor car, and when you haven't got the recessed floor, and you've got this very, the line is virtually the same underneath. You've got this long, flat, almost airfoil.
Yeah. Interestingly, Tim was just telling me off camera, I was asking about the flat floor and how much the welds make a difference in terms of the space that you get. And it was something about five inches.
You get a theoretical, from personal experience, it feels like a theoretical 4 to 5 inches of extra room, although you haven't got that in the recess, just in having that movement.
Which is a big difference.
Which is a big difference.
How comfortable you are when you're sitting there, for sure. Right, okay. Well, thanks for showing us the underside of that. We'll get this down and we'll have a quick look at 2 and 3. And we've, generally speaking, we've gone around, as we've gone around this, it's similar things for 2 and 3 anyway. So we'll just be looking at much more of a kind of a lighter touch as we go around those cars.
Absolutely, certainly on the two. The mechanicals are, you know, pretty much identical. There's some very slight differences with the engine. With the two having a long stud engine rather than the short stud engine that's in the Series 1.
Yeah.
But with this car having the Series 2 brakes on it, the mechanicals and what to look for on the body and all that side of it are more or less the same.
Great. Let's go take a look. Okay, conveniently straight into Series 2 then.
Yeah, so we've got the Series 2 here. The basic principles are the same as the one. There's a few subtle differences. It's still a derivative of the XK engine. The easy way to tell the Series 2, if you look down the side, you've got the multiple core plugs. You only have 3 core plugs in the side of a Series 1 4.2.
Yep.
So the block changed slightly. That's the giveaway. But and this engine ran right the way through into the late XJ60s, into the 80s. So it's, you know, how long lived it was. The radiator and coolant system, again, is slightly different. You'll notice that... Go on.
Is that why the sort of the at the front there, it's slightly wider mouthed?
No, there's actually no height difference across. It's still the same engine frames. It's still the same subframes.
Yeah.
The mouth became wider. Arguably, yes, it would get more air in. I think it was more of a design exercise out to differentiate it from the Series 1, so people wanted the newer car.
Yes.
Because if it just kept evolving, you could, you know, it was the same. You want people to buy, you know, the new product, you facelift it.
Yes.
So you get people to buy the new product, you facelift it, this is the new one. It looks different to the old one. Buy the new one. Be seen in it. There were some, you know, mechanical benefits. I said the cooling system, for instance, so you get a twin fan cooling system that runs into a proper expansion tank. So when it gets hot now, rather than expanding to atmosphere and having to keep topping it up, it expands to the expansion tank, sucks it back into the coolant, sucks it back into the cooling system when it cools down. The cooling efficiency is better, and yes, the larger mouth on the grill of the Series 2 would certainly help with that. Look on the outside, the first thing everybody notices with the Series 1 is the outside, is the headlights. They're no longer covered. The bumpers sit slightly higher, and the indicators and side lights now sit underneath.
Yes.
Some of that would almost certainly have been for the US market and their lower statutories. It's like this, it is like day and night between the earlier cars with the enclosed headlights and these. Yeah. The beam pattern, they're much brighter, so it's a much easier car to drive at night. It's not to everybody's taste, but it's you know, at the time it was an improvement. If we move to the inside again, it's all pretty much the same. There are subtle changes to the trim, more facelift. The most prominent part is the center dash in the radio tower, with a move away from the toddle switches to rocker switches.
Yeah.
Ultimately more reliable, you know, stronger,
a bit more robust.
The toggles are quite easy to snap if you're a bit heavy handed.
They are absolutely a bit more robust. It was improvements in the day.
Yeah.
And you also had what are proper multi-point reclining seats.
Okay, yes. So they've got multi sort of positions.
You've got multi-position reclining seats, and there wasn't a headrest option.
Yeah. Okay, that's interesting. Yeah, okay. Interesting with the fixed head coupes. You see how much space there is from a practicality point of view. Are there any things on the fixed head coupes over the roadsters, where areas that you need to be sort of looking at between the things? Are there things that this car you need to be thinking about that the roadster doesn't have?
There are. We think bodywork wise, there's one thing to consider on the fixed heads outside of the roadster, and that's you have a proper inner wheel arch that can corrode. So whereupon it's a single skin on the roadster, it's a double skin wheel arch on the roadster, on the fixed head, sorry.
Fixed head, yeah.
So it's, you think we were talking about the strength of the car with a roadster. Not only have you got a roof, but you've also got a double skin wheel arch and adding strength there. So again, very, very strong car. You've got a lot of space in the back as well. There is a deceptive
proper boot.
There is a deceptive amount of space.
I just love the way it opens up that load space. It's so cool, isn't it?
It's great, isn't it?
Yeah.
And with the load space, which can be doubled, you can add to the load space with all fixed heads.
Oh wow, that goes down as well.
By dropping the panel, which makes a little hidden cubby box, and giving you, proper load space.
Yeah.
And two people could comfortably go touring for a week with luggage in there.
Yes, you could. Quite happy. Mm. Yeah. And again, actually, if you want to be open to the elements with this as well, you can pull the top back as well.
Yeah, you've got the Webasto sunroof on this car. Not always looked on with good grace.
No.
I happen to quite like them. I think if they're done properly, they're actually very good. Again, we see people complaining of Webastos, and usually it's because they're not fitted properly. Maybe the wood's rotted after 40 years and it just wants some new wood put in it. But generally, a well-fitting, properly set up Webasto doesn't leak, doesn't cause excessive wind noise, and when the sun's out,
you've got
almost modern panoramic roof
feel to it. Yeah.
The only other thing that is very obvious is the tail lights. Again, rear bumpers lifted, tail lights drop below.
So yeah, I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? When we look back to the Series 1, this is where you're seeing some of the sort of changes and upgrades that they've made, some of which, you know, we like, and others where you think that's probably the American market thing, you know, or maybe that they've been forced to do that to sort of modernise and go with the times. It comes down to a personal preference thing then,
personal
as well,
preference,
you know.
Yeah.
And budget, of course.
and budget. I mean, a Series 2 car offers, you know, it becomes a very good value for money compared to a Series 1 if you get a good one. Mm. You know, and you like the looks.
And then, so talking about what you know, bang for the buck, that sort of really brings us on to Series 3. Not only representing, you know, really good value relative to
a Series 1 or 1 or 2. But this one here, the Series 3 Roadster, it's a real tour of this. You said earlier on to me that, you know, we're still thinking of these as very much, you know, sports cars when you think of E-types, but actually this is a gentleman cruiser.
It's a gentleman's express.
The seats now have, you know, headrests in here. The we've got that space. We haven't, you know, we've got a deeper footwell in there.
Absolutely.
Than the series ones.
You have an extra 9 inches in the wheelbase, and which is all in the middle of the car, so it's all legroom.
Yeah. So the passenger can get the chair back, recline.
You can get the chair back,
more.
You can recline. This doesn't have original seats in it, has sort of period looking modern seats.
Yes.
But even with the period seats, you know, you get headrest, you get reclining mechanism, you know, you've got this, and there's a lot of leg room in there.
Yeah. And what engine has this one got? So by the time we get to what year are we at now?
So year wise, we're at 73-74.
Yeah.
All Series 3s have the Jaguar V12 engine, which is an all-aluminium engine. It's actually a very robust unit. It's a very lazy unit. A lot of the you do need to be careful when you buy. Double the cylinders, I won't say double the cost, but double the problems when it goes wrong.
Yes.
But as long as they've been looked after, they don't tend to go wrong. The problems we see as a business with V12s is poorly maintained, wrong oils, wrong antifreezes.
Yeah.
As long as the engine is serviced and set up and running properly, they run for tens of thousands of miles without problem.
And when you say a lazy unit, you don't mean that in terms of the performance is sluggish, do you?
No, absolutely. They're not sluggish by any standard, even modern standards.
It's just that perhaps that V12 has been sort of tuned in a certain
exactly.
way.
Exactly. My description of a lazy engine is an engine that doesn't ask for anything. It doesn't ask to be revved. It just delivers.
Yeah. So it's quite a torquey engine.
So it's a torquey engine. It's a quietly powerful engine.
So you can probably just stick that into fourth and just all day long.
Yeah. Once you're doing 15 miles an hour, you can put it in fourth gear and just sit there.
Yeah.
You wouldn't need another gear.
Yeah.
On the V12, if we open the bonnet, very familiar all the way through the E-types.
It does start to look differently, doesn't it? I mean, if you look immediately looking at these plates, you start to see all these sort of pipes and pulleys
all the
around
vacuum pipes.
When you go to the
XJS,
always when you open up an XJS, I always sort of think of a power station because it's like this times 10 in terms of the busyness of what's going on.
Absolutely. Although you've got the extra 9 inches, and there are there are differences in the way the monocoque part of it is constructed because of that. The basic principle is still the same. You're still on you're still torsion bar front suspension. You're still on an IRS, which the basic principles are the same as the one and the two.
Yeah.
The basic principles of the torsion bar suspension system is the same. It's still on stressed chromoly front subframe. The bonnet, although the bonnet, the construction of the bonnet is still the same. So all the principles of looking for the corrosion, the cracks, the stresses, would be the same as a Series 1 or a Series 2. The difference you have with the V12 is the engine. The gearbox, the four-speed gearbox is the same, with long tail housing, with the extra wheelbase, the differential, the rear brakes, all very much akin to the Series 2. You did get vented discs on the front to cope with the extra weight.
Yes. Because how much more does something like this weigh from a Series 1?
It is a heavier car. I'm not sure of the exact weight, but it's a heavier car. It's with the extra wheelbase. The engine, they're probably not that much in the engine actually, with it being,
with it being an
all aluminium block compared to the cast iron block of the
of
the 4.2s. But it's overall, a bigger car.
Oh yeah.
The thing that is worth thinking about if you're looking at buying a V12 or you're thinking of it is the engine is incredibly smooth. very, very smooth. And unless you are akin to listen out for it, it's very difficult to tell if you're down on one cylinder.
Right.
You wouldn't. You probably wouldn't even notice it. We had a guy who did a tour and he thought he had oiled a spark plug up and carried on driving it. He cleaned it, put it back in, carried on driving it, didn't think there was a problem. He came back and the one cylinder had just gone completely.
Oh, wow. Just didn't notice.
And he just didn't notice.
What's
because
the, what's
so
the best
smooth
way
and so that, powerful.
That someone like myself can check that?
I mean, the only real way is to compression test.
Yeah.
You can notice a very slight fluffiness if you're down on a cylinder.
Yeah.
Or, you know, if you give it a, sometimes if you give it a bit of welly, and nobody should mind them being given a bit of welly. If somebody doesn't want you to open the car up, I've always thought, what do you not want me to see?
Yes. Yeah, very true.
You can generally feel it higher up as well.
Yeah.
But really the only way is to it's a drop compression test, which is where it comes to having, you know, if you're going to spend, you know, at the top end of the Series 3 drop head market, £120,000-£130,000, wow. why wouldn't you pay somebody £600-£800 to go and check it for you?
No, makes sense.
With all Jaguars, they use electronic oil gauge. They can be unreliable. They're very easy to check because this is the oil pressure sender on a V12. Very easy to check with an independent gauge. But really, other than the same principles of the Series 1, just check for any crankcase pressure. You know, simply running, take the, as you would with any classic car, take the filler off, see if it's breathing. They don't tend to go wrong. They don't tend to suffer from the front and rear crank oil seal problems of the earlier cars.
Yeah.
They can leak, but they don't. The most common leaks on Series 3s is from the oil filter housing, or actually the oil filter canister. And that is generally because the seal hasn't been fitted properly when it's been serviced.
Well, I'm going to ask you that sort of million-dollar question now. Which one of the three then is your favourite, sort of personal favourite for you?
Is this one? Definitely. If I had the choice of two, I would have a very early fixed head, 3.8 fixed head coupe.
Yeah, lovely.
To look at, yes. And polish and show people.
Yeah.
And then if I had to drive something, it'd be a Series 3 drop head all day, every day. This is a car you could get in, go and drive it on holiday to Lake Como, spend a week around the lakes, drive it back in comfort, in style, without having to worry about it.
Well, that's it really, isn't it? You know, those of us who actually want to get out and use their cars, you want to be able to do trips like that and really create memories and experiences.
Absolutely.
With them.
And that's what owning a classic car is about.
Yeah.
It's everybody has a different personal enjoyment from a classic car. Mine's getting out, driving them and enjoying them. And to me, from the E-Type world, this is the car to do it in.
Fantastic. Well, look, thank you for taking the time to go through the three of these. We really appreciate it. And I'm sure it's helped somebody along their journey to buying our E-Type. Just one last thing. You want to hear the sound of that V12.
The sound of the V12. Okay.
Okay, fire up. So there you have it, all you need to know to get yourself one step closer to E-Type ownership. And if you are looking to get yourself into a Jaguar E-Type, do let us know which derivative and why. Thanks for watching and see you soon.